Jesus, also referred to as Jesus of Nazareth and Jesus Christ, was a first century Jewish preacher and religious leader. He is the central figure of Christianity. Most Christians believe he is the incarnation of God the Son and the awaited Messiah, Christ, prophesied in the Old Testament. Virtually all modern scholars of antiquity agree that Jesus existed historically, although the quest for the historical Jesus has produced little agreement on the historical reliability of the Gospels and on how closely the Jesus portrayed in the Bible reflects the historical Jesus. Jesus was a Galilean Jew who was baptized by John the Baptist and began his own ministry. He preached orally and was often referred to as Rabbi. Jesus debated with fellow Jews on how to best follow God, engaged in healings, taught in parables, and gathered followers. He was arrested and tried by the Jewish authorities, turned over to the Roman government, and crucified on the order of Pontius Pilate, the Roman prefect. After his death, his followers believe he rose from the dead, and the community they formed eventually became the early church. Christian doctrines include the beliefs that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit, was born of a virgin named Mary, performed miracles, founded the Christian church, died by crucifixion as a sacrifice to achieve atonement for sin, rose from the dead, and ascended into heaven, from where he will return. Most Christians believe Jesus enables people to be reconciled to God. The Nicene Creed asserts that Jesus will judge the living and the dead either before or after their bodily resurrection, an event tied to the second coming of Jesus in Christian eschatology. The great majority of Christians worship Jesus as the incarnation of God the Son, the second of three persons of the Trinity. A minority of Christian denominations reject Trinitarianism, wholly or partly, as non-scriptural. The birth of Jesus is celebrated annually on December 25th, or various dates in January by some Eastern churches, as Christmas. His crucifixion is honored on Good Friday and his resurrection on Easter. The widely used calendar era, AD, from the Latin Anno Domini, in the year of the Lord, and the equivalent alternative, CE, are based on the approximate birth date of Jesus. Jesus is also revered in non-Christian religions. In Islam, Jesus, commonly transliterated as Isa, is considered one of God's important prophets and the Messiah. Muslims believe Jesus was a bringer of scripture and was born of a virgin, but was not the Son of God. The Quran states that Jesus never claimed divinity. Most Muslims do not believe he was crucified, but that he was physically raised into heaven by God. In contrast, Judaism rejects the belief that Jesus was the awaited Messiah, arguing that he did not fulfill messianic prophecies and was neither divine nor resurrected. A typical Jew in Jesus' time had only one name, sometimes followed by the phrase son of their father's name or the individual's hometown. Thus, in the New Testament, Jesus is commonly referred to as Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus' neighbors in Nazareth refer to him as the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon. Mark chapter 6, verse 3. The carpenter's son, Matthew chapter 13, verse 55, or Joseph's son, Luke chapter 4, verse 22. In John, the disciple Philip refers to him as Jesus, son of Joseph, from Nazareth. The name Jesus is derived from the Latin Iesus, a transliteration of the Greek Iesousos. The Greek form is a rendering of the Hebrew Yeshua, a variant of the earlier name Yehoshua, or in English, Joshua, meaning Yah saves. This was also the name of Moses' successor and of a Jewish high priest in the Old Testament. The name Yeshua appears to have been used in Judea at the time of the birth of Jesus. The first century works of historian Flavius Josephus, who wrote in Koine Greek, the same language as that of the New Testament, refer to at least 20 different people with the name Jesus. The etymology of Jesus' name in the context of the New Testament is generally given as Yahweh is salvation. Since early Christianity, Christians have commonly referred to Jesus as Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the name that the author of the Gospel of John claims Jesus gave to himself during his high priestly prayer. The word Christ was a title or office, the Christ, not a given name. It derives from the Greek Christos, a translation of the Hebrew Mashiach, meaning anointed, and is usually transliterated into English as Messiah. In biblical Judaism, sacred oil was used to anoint certain exceptionally holy people and objects as part of their religious investiture. Christians of the time designated Jesus as the Christ because they believed him to be the Messiah, whose arrival is prophesied in the Hebrew Bible and Old Testament. In post-biblical usage, Christ became viewed as a name, one part of Jesus Christ. The term Christian, meaning a follower of Christ, has been in use since the first century. Jesus was Jewish, born by Mary, wife of Joseph. The Gospels of Matthew and Luke offer two accounts of the genealogy of Jesus. Matthew traces Jesus' ancestry to Abraham through David. Luke traces Jesus' ancestry through Adam to God. The lists are identical between Abraham and David, but differ radically from that point. Matthew has 27 generations from David to Joseph, whereas Luke has 42, with almost no overlap between the names on the two lists. Various theories have been put forward seeking to explain why the two genealogies are so different. Matthew and Luke each describe Jesus' birth, especially that Jesus was born by a virgin named Mary in Bethlehem in fulfillment of prophecy. Luke's account emphasizes events before the birth of Jesus and centers on Mary, while Matthew's mostly covers those after the birth and centers on Joseph. Both accounts state that Jesus was born to Joseph and Mary, his betrothed, in Bethlehem, and both support the doctrine of the virgin birth of Jesus, according to which Jesus was miraculously conceived by the Holy Spirit in Mary's womb when she was still a virgin. At the same time, there is evidence, at least in the Lucan Acts of the Apostles, that Jesus was thought to have had, like many figures in antiquity, a dual paternity, since there is stated that he descended from the seed or loins of David. By taking him as his own, Joseph will give him the necessary Davidic descent. In Matthew, Joseph is troubled because Mary, his betrothed, is pregnant. Matthew chapter 1, verse 19 through 20. But in the first of Joseph's three dreams, an angel assures him not to be afraid to take Mary as his wife because her child was conceived by the Holy Spirit. In Matthew chapter 2, verse 1 through 12, wise men or magi from the east bring gifts to the young Jesus as the King of the Jews. They find Jesus in a house in Bethlehem and not a barn, and Jesus is now a child and not an infant. In Matthew, Herod the Great hears of Jesus' birth and, wanting him killed, orders the murders of male infants in Bethlehem under the age of 2. But an angel warns Joseph in his second dream, and the family flees to Egypt, later to return and settle in Nazareth. In Luke chapter 1, verse 31 through 38, Mary learns from the angel Gabriel that she will conceive and bear a child called Jesus through the action of the Holy Spirit. When Mary is due to give birth, she and Joseph travel from Nazareth to Joseph's ancestral home in Bethlehem to register in the census ordered by Caesar Augustus. While there, Mary gives birth to Jesus, and as they have found no room in the inn, she places the newborn in a manger. An angel announces the birth to some shepherds who go to Bethlehem to see Jesus and subsequently spread the news abroad. After the presentation of Jesus at the temple, Joseph, Mary, and Jesus return to Nazareth. Jesus' childhood home is identified in the Gospels of Luke and Matthew as the town of Nazareth in Galilee, where he lived with his family. Although Joseph appears in descriptions of Jesus' childhood, no mention is made of him thereafter. His other family members, his mother, Mary, his brothers, James, Joses or Joseph, Judas, and Simon, and his unnamed sisters, are mentioned in the Gospels and other sources. The Gospel of Mark reports that Jesus comes into conflict with his neighbors and family. Jesus' mother and brothers come to get him because people are saying that he is crazy. Jesus responds that his followers are his true family. In John, Mary follows Jesus to his crucifixion, and he expresses concern over her well-being. Jesus is called a tecton in Mark chapter 6, verse 3, traditionally understood as carpenter, but could cover makers of objects in various materials, including builders. The Gospels indicate that Jesus could read, paraphrase, and debate scripture, but this does not necessarily mean that he received formal scribal training. When Jesus is presented as a baby in the temple per Jewish law, a man named Simeon says to Mary and Joseph that Jesus shall stand as a sign of contradiction while a sword will pierce your own soul. Then the secret thoughts of many will come to light. Luke chapter 2, verse 28 through 35. Several years later, when Jesus goes missing on a visit to Jerusalem, his parents find him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking questions, and the people are amazed at his understanding and answers. Mary scolds Jesus for going missing, to which Jesus replies that he must be in his Father's house. The synoptic accounts of Jesus' baptism are all preceded by information about John the Baptist. They show John preaching penance and repentance for the remission of sins and encouraging the giving of alms to the poor, Luke chapter 3, verse 11, as he baptizes people in the area of the Jordan River around Perea and foretells in Luke chapter 3, verse 16, the arrival of someone more powerful than he. Later, Jesus identifies John as the Elijah who was to come. Matthew chapter 11, verse 14, Mark chapter 9, verse 13 through 14. The prophet who was expected to arrive before the great and terrible day of the Lord, Malachi chapter 4, verse 5. Likewise, Luke says that John had the spirit and power of Elijah, Luke chapter 1, verse 17. In Mark, John baptizes Jesus, and as he comes out of the water, he sees the Holy Spirit descending to him like a dove, and he hears a voice from heaven declaring him to be God's son. Mark chapter 1, verse 9 through 11. This is one of two events described in the Gospels where a voice from heaven calls Jesus son, the other being the transfiguration. The Spirit then drives him into the wilderness where he is tempted by Satan. Jesus then begins his ministry after John's arrest. Jesus' baptism in Matthew is similar. Here, before Jesus' baptism, John protests, saying, "I need to be baptized by you." Jesus instructs him to carry on with the baptism to fulfill all righteousness. Matthew also details the three temptations that Satan offers Jesus in the wilderness. Matthew chapter 4, verse 3 through 11. In Luke, the Holy Spirit descends as a dove after everyone has been baptized and Jesus is praying. John implicitly recognizes Jesus from prison after sending his followers to ask about him. Jesus' baptism and temptation serves as preparation for his public ministry. The Gospel of John leaves out Jesus' baptism and temptation. Here, John the Baptist testifies that he saw the Spirit descend on Jesus. John publicly proclaims Jesus as the sacrificial Lamb of God, and some of John's followers become disciples of Jesus. In this gospel, John denies that he is Elijah. Before John is in prison, Jesus leads his followers to baptize disciples as well, and they baptize more people than John. The synoptics depict two distinct geographical settings in Jesus' ministry. The first takes place north of Judea, in Galilee, where Jesus conducts a successful ministry, and the second shows Jesus rejected and killed when he travels to Jerusalem. Often referred to as Rabbi, Jesus preaches his message orally. Notably, Jesus forbids those who recognize him as the Messiah to speak of it, including people he heals and demons he exorcises. John depicts Jesus' ministry as largely taking place in and around Jerusalem rather than in Galilee, and Jesus' divine identity is openly proclaimed and immediately recognized. Scholars divide the ministry of Jesus into several stages. The Galilean ministry begins when Jesus returns to Galilee from the Judean desert after rebuffing the temptation of Satan. Jesus preaches around Galilee, and in Matthew chapter 4, verse 18 through 20, his first disciples, who will eventually form the core of the early church, encounter him and begin to travel with him. This period includes the Sermon on the Mount, one of Jesus' major discourses, as well as the calming of the storm, the feeding of the 5,000, walking on water, and a number of other miracles and parables. It ends with the confession of Peter and the transfiguration. As Jesus travels towards Jerusalem in the Perean ministry, he returns to the area where he was baptized, about a third of the way down from the Sea of Galilee, along the Jordan River. The final ministry in Jerusalem begins with Jesus' triumphal entry into the city on Palm Sunday. In the Synoptic Gospels, during that week, Jesus drives the money changers from the Second Temple, and Judas bargains to betray him. This period culminates in the Last Supper and the Farewell Discourse. Near the beginning of his ministry, Jesus appoints 12 apostles. In Matthew and Mark, despite Jesus only briefly requesting that they join him, Jesus' first apostles, who were fishermen, are described as immediately consenting and abandoning their nets and boats to do so. Matthew chapter 4, verse 18 through 22, and Mark chapter 1, verse 16 through 20. In John, Jesus' first two apostles were disciples of John the Baptist. The Baptist sees Jesus and calls him the Lamb of God. The two hear this and follow Jesus. In addition to the 12 apostles, the opening of the passage of the Sermon on the Plain identifies a much larger group of people as disciples. Also, in Luke chapter 10, verse 1 through 16, Jesus sends 70 or 72 of his followers in pairs to prepare towns for his prospective visit. They are instructed to accept hospitality, heal the sick, and spread the word that the kingdom of God is coming. In Mark, the disciples are notably obtuse. They fail to understand Jesus' miracles, his parables, or what rising from the dead would mean. When Jesus is later arrested, they desert him. In the Synoptics, Jesus teaches extensively, often in parables, about the kingdom of God, or in Matthew, the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom is described as both imminent and already present in the ministry of Jesus. Luke chapter 17, verse 21. Jesus promises inclusion in the kingdom for those who accept his message. Jesus talks of the Son of Man, an apocalyptic figure who would come to gather the chosen. Jesus calls people to repent their sins and to devote themselves completely to God. Jesus tells his followers to adhere to Jewish law, although he is perceived by some to have broken the law himself. For example, regarding the Sabbath. When asked what the greatest commandment is, Jesus replies, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 through 39. Other ethical teachings of Jesus include loving your enemies, refraining from hatred and lust, turning the other cheek, and giving people who have sinned against you. Matthew chapter 5 through 7. John's gospel presents the teachings of Jesus not merely as his own preaching, but as divine revelation. John the Baptist, for example, states in John chapter 3, verse 34, "He whom God has sent speaks the words of God, for he gives the Spirit without measure." In John chapter 7, verse 16, Jesus says, "My teaching is not mine, but his who sent me." He asserts the same thing in John chapter 14, verse 10. "Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works." Approximately 30 parables from about one-third of Jesus' recorded teachings. The parables appear within longer sermons and at other places in the narrative. They often contain symbolism and usually relate the physical world to the spiritual. Common themes in these tales include the kindness and generosity of God and the perils of transgression. Some of his parables, such as the prodigal son, are relatively simple, while others, such as the growing seed, Mark chapter 4, verse 26 through 29, are sophisticated, profound, and abstruse. When asked by his disciples about why he speaks in parables to the people, Jesus replies that the chosen disciples have been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven. Unlike the rest of their people, "For the one who has will be given more, and he will have in abundance, but the one who does not have will be deprived even more." Going on to say that the majority of their generation have grown dull hearts and thus are unable to understand. Matthew chapter 13, verse 10 through 17. In the gospel accounts, Jesus devotes a large portion of his ministry performing miracles, especially healings. The miracles can be classified into two main categories: healing miracles and nature miracles. The healing miracles include cures for physical ailments, exorcisms, and resurrections of the dead. The nature miracles show Jesus' power over nature, and including turning water into wine, walking on water, and calming a storm, among others. Jesus states that his miracles are from a divine source. When Jesus' opponents suddenly accuse him of performing exorcisms by the power of Beelzebub, the prince of demons, Jesus counters that he performs them by the Spirit of God, Matthew chapter 12, verse 28, or finger of God, arguing that all logic suggests that Satan would not let his demons assist the children of God because it would divide Satan's house and bring his kingdom to desolation. Furthermore, he asks his opponents that if he exercises by Beelzebub, by whom do your sons cast them out? Luke chapter 11, verse 20. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 31 through 32, he goes on to say that while all manner of sin, even insults against God, or insults against the Son of Man, shall be forgiven, whoever insults goodness or the Holy Spirit shall never be forgiven. he or she carries the guilt of his or her sin forever. In John, Jesus' miracles are described as signs performed to prove his mission and divinity. However, in the synoptics, when asked by some teachers of the law and some Pharisees to give miraculous signs to prove his authority, Jesus refuses, saying that no sign shall come to corrupt and evil people except the sign of the prophet Jonah. Also, in the synoptic gospels, the crowds regularly respond to Jesus' miracles with awe and press on him to heal their sick. In John's gospel, Jesus is presented as unpressured by the crowds, who often respond to his miracles with trust and faith. One characteristic shared among all miracles of Jesus in the gospel accounts is that he performed them freely and never requested or accepted any form of payment. The gospel episodes that include descriptions of miracles of Jesus also include teachings, and the miracles themselves involve an element of teaching. Many of the miracles teach the importance of faith, and the cleansing of 10 leopards and the raising of Jairus' daughter, for instance, the beneficiaries are told that their healing was due to their faith. The Last Supper is the final meal that Jesus shares with his 12 apostles in Jerusalem before his crucifixion. The Last Supper is mentioned in all four canonical gospels. Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians also refers to it. During the meal, Jesus predicts that one of his apostles will betray him. Despite each apostle's assertion that he would not betray him, Jesus reiterates that the betrayer would be one of those present. Matthew chapter 26, verse 23 through 25, and John chapter 13, verse 26 through 27, specifically identified Judas as the traitor. In the synoptics, Jesus takes bread, breaks it, and gives it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you." He then has them all drink from a cup, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." Luke chapter 22, verse 19 through 20. The Christian sacrament, or ordinance of the Eucharist, is based on these events. Although the Gospel of John does not include a description of the bread and wine ritual during the Last Supper, most scholars agree that John chapter 6, 22 through 59, the Bread of Life discourse, has a Eucharistic character and resonates with the institution narratives in the Synoptic Gospels and in the Pauline writings on the Last Supper. In all four Gospels, Jesus predicts that Peter will deny knowledge of him three times before the rooster crows the next morning. In Luke and John, the prediction is made during the supper, Luke chapter 22, verse 34, John chapter 22, verse 34. In Matthew and Mark, the prediction is made after the supper. Jesus also predicts that all his disciples will desert him, Matthew chapter 26, verse 31 through 34, Mark chapter 14, verse 27 through 30. The Gospel of John provides the only account of Jesus washing his disciples' feet after the meal. John also includes a long sermon by Jesus preparing his disciples, now without Judas, for his departure. Chapters 14 through 17 of the Gospel of John are known as the Farewell Discourse and are a significant source of Christological content. Jesus' crucifixion is described in all four canonical Gospels. After the trials, Jesus is led to Calvary, carrying his cross. The route traditionally thought to have been taken is known as the Via Dolorosa. The three synoptic Gospels indicate that Simon of Cyrene assist him, having been compelled by the Romans to do so. In Luke chapter 23, verse 27 through 28, Jesus tells the women in the multitude of people following him not to weep for him, but for themselves and their children. At Calvary, Jesus is offered a sponge soaked in a concoction usually offered as a painkiller. According to Matthew and Mark, he refuses it. The soldiers then crucified Jesus and cast lots for his clothes. Above Jesus' head on the cross is Pilate's inscription, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Soldiers and passersby mock him about it. Two convicted thieves are crucified along with Jesus. In Matthew and Mark, both thieves mock Jesus. In Luke, one of them rebukes Jesus while the other defends him. Jesus tells the latter, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Luke chapter 23, verse 43. In John, Mary, the mother of Jesus, and a beloved disciple were at the crucifixion. Jesus tells the beloved disciple to take care of his mother. The Roman soldiers break the two thieves' legs, but they do not break those of Jesus, as he is already dead. In John chapter 19, verse 34, one soldier pierces Jesus' side with a lance, and blood and water flow out. In the synoptics, when Jesus dies, the heavy curtain at the temple is torn. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 51 through 54, an earthquake breaks open tombs. In Matthew and Mark, terrified by the events, a Roman centurion states that Jesus was the Son of God. On the same day, Joseph of Arimathea, with Pilate's permission and with Nicodemus's help, removes Jesus' body from the cross, wraps him in a clean cloth, and buries him in his new rock-hewn tomb. In Matthew chapter 27, 62 through 66, on the following day, the chief Jewish priests ask Pilate for the tomb to be secured, and with Pilate's permission, the priests place seals on the large stone covering the entrance. Mary Magdalene, alone in the Gospel of John, but accompanied by other women in the synoptics, goes to Jesus' tomb on Sunday morning and is surprised to find it empty. Despite Jesus' teaching, the disciples had not understood that Jesus would rise again. In Matthew, there are guards at the tomb. An angel descends from heaven and opens the tomb. The guards faint from fear. Jesus appears to Mary Magdalene and the other Mary after they visited the tomb. Jesus then appears to the 11 remaining disciples in Galilee and commissions them to baptize all nations in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In Mark, Salome and Mary, mother of James, are with Mary Magdalene. In the tomb, a young man in a white robe, an angel, tells them that Jesus will meet his disciples in Galilee as he had told them, referring to Mark chapter 14, verse 28. In Luke, Mary and various other women meet two angels at the tomb, but the 11 disciples do not believe their story. Jesus appears to two of his followers in Emmaus. He also makes an appearance to Peter. Jesus then appears the same day to his disciples in Jerusalem. Although he appears and vanishes mysteriously, he also eats and lets them touch him to prove that he is not a spirit. He repeats his command to bring his teaching to all nations. In John, Mary is alone at first, but Peter and a beloved disciple come and see the tomb as well. Jesus then appears to Mary at the tomb. He later appears to the disciples, breathes on them, and gives them the power to forgive and retain sins. In a second visit to disciples, he proves to a doubting disciple, doubting Thomas, that he is flesh and blood. The disciples return to Galilee, where Jesus makes another appearance. He performs a miracle known as the catch of 153 fish at the Sea of Galilee, after which Jesus encourages Peter to serve his followers. Jesus' ascension into heaven is described in Luke chapter 24, verse 50 through 53, Acts chapter 1, verse 1 through 11, and mentioned in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. In the Acts of the Apostles, 40 days after the resurrection, as the disciples look on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 22 states that Jesus has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God. The Acts of the Apostles describes several appearances of Jesus after his ascension. In Acts chapter 7, verse 55, Stephen gazes into heaven and sees Jesus standing at the right hand of God just before his death. On the road to Damascus, the Apostle Paul is converted to Christianity after seeing a blinding light and hearing a voice saying, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." In Acts chapter 9, verse 10 through 18, Jesus instructs Ananias of Damascus in a vision to heal Paul. The book of Revelation includes a revelation from Jesus concerning the last days. Modern research on a historical Jesus has not led to a unified picture of the historical figure, partly because of the variety of academic traditions represented by the scholars. Given the scarcity of historical sources, it is generally difficult for any scholar to construct a portrait of Jesus that can be considered historically valid beyond the basic elements of his life. The portraits of Jesus constructed in these quests often differ from each other and from the image portrayed in the Gospels. Jesus is seen as the founder of, in the words of Sanders, a renewal movement within Judaism. One of the criteria used to discern historical details in the third quest is the criterion of plausibility, relative to Jesus' Jewish context and to his influence on Christianity. A disagreement in contemporary research is whether Jesus was apocalyptic. Most scholars conclude that he was an apocalyptic preacher like John the Baptist and Paul the Apostle. In contrast, certain prominent North American scholars, such as Burton Mack and John Dominic Crossan, advocate for non-eschatological Jesus, one who is more of a cynic sage than an apocalyptic preacher. In addition to portraying Jesus as an apocalyptic prophet, a charismatic healer, or a cynic philosopher, some scholars portray him as the true Messiah or egalitarian prophet of social change. However, the attributes described in the portraits sometimes overlap, and the scholars who differ on some attributes sometimes agree on others. Since the 18th century, scholars have occasionally put forth that Jesus was a political national messiah. But the evidence for this portrait is negligible. Likewise, the proposal that Jesus was a zealot does not fit with the earliest strata of the synoptic tradition. Modern research on a historical Jesus has not led to a unified picture of the historical figure, partly because of the variety of academic traditions represented by the scholars. Given the scarcity of historical sources, it is generally difficult for any scholar to construct a portrait of Jesus that can be considered historically valid beyond the basic elements of his life. The portraits of Jesus constructed in these quests often differ from each other and from the image portrayed in the Gospels. After Jesus' death, his followers said he rose from the dead. The followers of Jesus formed a community to wait for his return and the founding of his kingdom.